गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल ऑफ यू। एम ए ऑडिबल? ओके, स्लाइड्स आर विजिबल? गुड आफ्टरनून। ओके, अगेन टुडे इज द कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ व्हाट वी वर स्टडिंग इन द प्रीवियस टू क्लासेस, दैट इज द ऑटोनॉमिक नर्वस सिस्टम। ओके, सो टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विथ द सिंपैथेटिक डिवीजन ऑफ योर ऑटोनॉमिक नर्वस सिस्टम। ओके, द जनरल एनाटॉमी वी हैड कंप्लीटेड। Had studied last class about the neurons, that is the preganglionic and the postganglionic neurons. Today we will start again with the sympathetic ganglia that we have already started in the previous class. So sympathetic ganglia is divided into your three types. Okay, first one is your paravertebral, second is your prevertebral, last one is your terminal. So three types: paravertebral, prevertebral and terminal. So the paravertebral ganglia, it's present on two on the either side, and it is again divided into your cervical, thoracic, lumbar and sacral. This part we had already completed in the last class: cervical, thoracic, lumbar and sacral. Again, the cervical ganglia, we have superior, middle and inferior. Okay, so thoracic, as you know, there are 12 thoracic ganglia. Okay, T1 to T2, T1 and T2, they supply your head and neck. T3 and T4 will supply your thoracic viscera. T5 to T9 will supply your upper limb. T6 to T12 will supply the upper abdominal viscera. The lumbar and sacral ganglia, three lumbar segments, L1, L2 and L3. There may be two additional lumbar and four sacral ganglia present. Okay, the so T10 to L2 preganglionic fibers supply the lower lip, and L1 and L2 will supply your lower abdominal viscera. So the paravertebral ganglia, that is present two on the either side, it's divided into your four types of ganglia: cervical, thoracic, lumbar and sacral. Till this much we had completed in the previous class. So today we are going to continue the next set of ganglia, that is the prevertebral ganglia. Again, it is divided into three types. Okay, first one is your celiac ganglion, second is your superior mesenteric ganglion, and third is your inferior mesenteric ganglion. Celiac ganglion, superior mesenteric ganglion, inferior mesenteric ganglia, and these prevertebral ganglia are otherwise also termed as your collateral ganglia. Okay, the postsynaptic neurons for the abdominal and pelvic visceral organs, they arise from your prevertebral ganglia. Okay, coming to each one of them, the celiac ganglion, the preganglionic axons, they originate from your T5 to T12 spinal level. Function, they provide innervation to your stomach, small intestine, liver, pancreas, gallbladder, spleen and kidney. Okay, T5 to T12, this is your celiac ganglia. They provide innervation to your stomach, small intestine, liver, pancreas, gallbladder, spleen and kidneys. Then coming to the superior mesenteric ganglia, preganglionic fibers, they originate from T10 to T12 and they innervate your small and large intestine. Now coming to the inferior mesenteric ganglia, the fibers, they originate from L1 to L3 and will innervate the lower part of your colon, rectum, urinary bladder and reproductive organs. So these three types of ganglia that comes under your prevertebral ganglia, okay, and what are they? Celiac ganglia, superior mesenteric ganglia and inferior mesenteric ganglia. Now coming to the last set of sympathetic ganglia, that is your terminal ganglia, okay. So these are located in the organs that are innervated by your sympathetic fibers. For examples, they are your adrenal medulla, heart, pancreas and urinary bladder. Coming to the adrenal medulla, the cells of the adrenal medulla are innervated by the preganglionic sympathetic fibers, which originates in the lower thoracic segments, spinal segments that travel in your lesser splanchnic nerve. Okay, who will tell me what is the other name for adrenal medulla in relation to your sympathetic division? Any other name given to the adrenal medulla in relation to their acting as a sympathetic ganglion? Anyone? You want me to repeat the question? The other name for adrenal medulla in relation of them having functions as your sympathetic fibers. Okay, yes is over now. Answers. So if you don't know, listen carefully, I'll tell you the answer after 3 or 4 slides. Okay. Okay. So the preganglionic fibers, they terminate on your chromaffin cells, the specialized cells of the adrenal medulla that represents your modified ganglion cells. Okay. Now the chromaffin cells will synthesize both your epinephrine and norepinephrine. The other terminal ganglia, that is your heart, pancreas and urinary bladder, they are also modified postganglionic cells. Okay, the postganglionic cells in the heart, for example, intrinsic cardiac adrenergic cells, they will influence the development of the heart during your fetal life. Now coming to the neurotransmitters that are secreted from the sympathetic division. All preganglionic fibers, remember this, all preganglionic fibers are cholinergic and sympathetic postganglionic fibers are adrenergic. Okay. All preganglionic fibers are cholinergic and sympathetic postganglionic fibers are adrenergic. That means they secrete either your noradrenaline or adrenaline. The postganglionic sympathetic fibers will supply your sweat glands and blood vessels of skeletal muscles, blood vessels of heart, lungs, kidneys, uterus. They receive your cholinergic innervation. Accordingly, also their functions. So you have to remember which fibers supplying which structures. Okay. Now coming to this table, preganglionic neurons from your spinal segments and the structures innervated by the postganglionic fibers. So T1 and T2, see, it is dilator pupillae, mucous muscles, blood vessels, sweat glands of your head and neck. T3 and T4, they supply your heart, esophagus, trachea, bronchi and lungs. T5 to T9, blood vessels and sweat glands of your upper limbs. T6 to T12, GI tract, liver, urinary tract, adrenal medulla and spleen. T10 to L2, that is supply your blood vessels, sweat glands of your lower limbs. So T5 to T9, blood vessels and sweat glands of upper limbs. T10 to L2 is your blood vessels and sweat glands of your lower limbs. L1 and L3 will supply bladder, uterus, fallopian tube, testes, vasa deferens, seminal vesicles and prostate. Okay, so these are the preganglionic neurons and the structures that are innervated by the postganglionic neurons. Now coming to the functions or responses of sympathetic division. So there are two types of responses based on the activities. First one is your basal level activity, that is just the introduction or the start of any response, and then is the widespread response, that means during any emergency situations. Okay, first basal level activity, which is at rest, and widespread response following activation. So what is the meaning of this basal sympathetic activity? The basal rate of discharge is termed as your basal sympathetic tone, and the functions of many viscera can be altered by changing the level of sympathetic discharge to the organs. For example, change in heart rate and blood pressure in response to your change in posture. So when there is any physiological change in or alteration, the sympathetic discharge to the organs can be controlled. Now the next one is your widespread sympathetic response. So this is due to the activation of your sympathetic division. And the very important example of this is your fight and flight reaction. Okay, it is again of two types. First one is your sympathetic divergence. What is this sympathetic divergence and why it occurs? Now so the number of postganglionic axons, okay, which emerge from your paravertebral ganglia. The postganglionic axons that is emerging from your paravertebral ganglia, the number is more when compared to the preganglionic neurons, which are originating from the spinal cord. So if you see the ratio of this postganglionic to preganglionic, it is 100:1. So if you compare, the postganglionic neurons are far more in number compared to the preganglionic neurons. So the conclusion we draw from this is that the effector tissue, okay, it is innervated by the sympathetic fibers, is more. Okay, the effector tissue innervated by the sympathetic fibers are more because the preganglionic neurons are far more compared to the postganglionic neurons are far more compared to the preganglionic neurons. Now this sympathetic divergence, okay, divergence in the term, it enables the sympathetic system to produce widespread responses by simultaneously modulating functions of many effector organs. So simultaneously the functions of many effector organs are being modulated. Again, this divergence, it is due to the branching of your preganglionic sympathetic axons in the paravertebral chain of ganglia that makes the synaptic connections with multiple postganglionic neurons. Why? Again, because preganglionic neurons are less, so they have to give out branches to connect to the postganglionic neurons. This is the divergence. Both where does this connections take place? It takes place both above and below their original level of emergence from your spinal cord. The next is the role of your adrenal medulla. Okay, so I had asked you a question, what is the other name for your adrenal medulla in connection to your sympathetic division? Okay, so it is otherwise a modified sympathetic ganglion, yes, and it is a neuroendocrine gland. Okay, neuroendocrine gland. The sympathetic system, it activates the hormonal mechanism to achieve its widespread responses. It is mediated by the catecholamine secreted from your adrenal medulla. Okay, the adrenomedullary secretion by your sympathetic activation, it forms your physiological basis of divergence for widespread sympathetic response. And adrenal medulla is a neuroendocrine gland, which is a modified sympathetic ganglion. Okay, so the responses are divided into two types. One is the basic one, other one is the widespread one. The widespread is again divided into two types. One is due to your sympathetic divergence and the other is due to the role of adrenal medulla. Now coming to the last part, that is the effects of sympathetic stimulation. So about this topic, effects of sympathetic stimulation, you must have already studied this in the various topics covered till now. What is the function of sympathetic stimulation on your various organs? So it is just the combination of all the functions which are by your sympathetic stimulations. So as you all know, the effects are mediated by the release of noradrenaline from your sympathetic nerve endings and adrenaline from your adrenal medulla. Okay, the effects via your adrenergic receptors. Now the catecholamines, They elicit their effects by acting on your adrenergic receptors. Adrenergic receptors are of two types, alpha and beta. Alpha receptor again is divided into two types, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Beta receptors are divided into three types, beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. And the beta receptors are more sensitive to your adrenaline, and alpha receptors are sensitive to your noradrenaline. Okay, so there was a disturbance. Are the slides visible now? Okay. Now let's study about each of the receptors and their functions. As you all know, alpha receptor is divided into your alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptors. So coming first to the alpha 1 receptor, what happens to its stimulation? Okay, first, where are they present? Okay, and what is the function? So you have to remember this. Where are these receptors present and what is their function? The alpha 1 receptors are present in your vascular smooth muscles of cutaneous and splanchnic circulation, sphincters of bladder and GI tract, and radial muscles of iris. Okay, present in vascular smooth muscles of cutaneous and splanchnic circulation, sphincters of bladder and GI tract, and radial muscle of iris. And what is the function? Stimulation causes your contraction or constriction. Contraction or constriction. They are sensitive to adrenaline and noradrenaline, and it is mediated by your intracellular IP3. So this is the only one receptor that is mediated by your intracellular IP3. The rest all are mediated by your cyclic AMP. Now coming to the effects of alpha 2 stimulation, where are they present? In the presynaptic nerve ending wall of GI tract, platelets and adipocytes. The function is relaxation or inhibition of your structure. Okay, so alpha 1 was contraction and constriction, alpha 2 is relaxation or inhibition. And they are mediated by decreased formation of intracellular cyclic AMP. Okay, so the alpha receptors, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Coming to the beta receptors, they are again divided into three types, beta 1, beta 2 and beta 3. So beta 1 receptors, these are present in your SA node, AV node and ventricular muscles. And the stimulation will cause excitation of these structures. Function is excitation. Okay, they are more sensitive to adrenaline than noradrenaline, and the effects are mediated by increased formation of your intracellular cyclic AMP. Okay, it causes your excitation. Stimulation causes your excitation. Now coming to beta 2 stimulation. Okay, these are present in your blood vessels of skeletal muscles, bronchial smooth muscles and wall of GI tract, and the stimulation will cause relaxation. So B1 was excitation, B2 is relaxation, and they are more sensitive to adrenaline than noradrenaline, and the effects are mediated by change in the level of your intracellular cyclic AMP. Now coming to the last one, B3 stimulation. These are present only in your adipose tissues and they cause lipolysis. And again, effect is mediated by increase in level of intracellular cyclic AMP. So if you conclude all these receptors, okay, adrenergic receptors, alpha and beta, So alpha is alpha 1, alpha 2, beta is beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. So alpha 1, it is present in your vascular smooth muscles of cutaneous and splanchnic circulation, then present in your GI tract, sphincters of your bladder, and it causes your contraction and constriction. Alpha 2, it is present in your presynaptic nerve endings, then you have walls of your GI tract, and it causes your relaxation or inhibition. Okay, just the opposite of alpha 1. So alpha 1, contraction and constriction. Alpha 2, relaxation or inhibition. Beta 1, it is present in your SA node, AV node, and it causes excitation. Beta 2, it is present in the blood vessels of skeletal muscles and wall of GI tract, and it causes your relaxation. So beta 1 is for excitation, beta 2 is for relaxation, and beta 3 is present in your adipose tissue and it causes lipolysis. So the in the next three table graphs, this you will find in almost all of the books. Okay, try to remember the effect of your sympathetic and parasympathetic stimulation. So parasympathetic we have not studied till now, but in the next class we will study. Okay, the sympathetic stimulation, eye, stellate pupillae, sphincter pupillae, ciliary muscles, Müller's muscles. Okay, so you have to at least remember one of the functions about your sympathetic stimulation on the effectors organs. So you have eye, you have glands, you have heart, blood vessels, cutaneous, skeletal, visceral, coronary, cerebral. Okay, then you have lung, skin, GI tract, pancreas, adrenal medulla, urinary system, and the other structures. Okay, so which are the receptors of the sympathetic system and what is their functions on your effector organs? So we have complete. Okay, this is important. Fight or flight response. Okay, already we have seen about this in your previous endocrine system. Okay, so I have noted down some of the important examples of your fight or flight response. What is this fight or flight response? It is a sympathetic response, okay, which is again comes in your widespread response of sympathetic activation. Okay, it occurs during your emergency situations, and the responses are due to the secretion of your catecholamines from your adrenal medulla. Okay, and it is due to your sympathetic stimulation. So what are the effects of this fight or flight response on the various organs? Okay, so if we take into account CVS, okay, it increases the blood pressure due to increased cardiac output and vasoconstriction. The first effect, CVS increases blood pressure due to increased cardiac output and vasoconstriction. In your lungs, it increased exchange of blood gases, which occurs due to your stimulation of your respiratory rate and dilation of your bronchiolar tree. Ultimately, this will increase the supply of oxygen to your tissues. Okay. Then sympathetic stimulation of your salivary gland will decrease salivary secretion. CVS increases the blood pressure. Lungs, the increased exchange of blood gases will release to the increased supply of oxygen to the tissue. Salivary gland, it decreases your salivary secretion. Then supply of metabolic substrates increases, again which is a very important component of your effective stress reaction. the glycogenolysis increases the plasma glucose concentration, and lipolysis will promote plasma free fatty acid level. All this again we have already studied in your previous classes, okay, endocrine classes. Sympathetic stimulation of sweat glands will cause secretion of the watery fluid and the evaporation of your body heat. Then activation of pyloerector muscles of hair follicles will cause a very important mechanism, that is your hair standing on skin. What happens to this hair erection? It helps in the preservation of your body temperature and it gives a ferocious appearance to threaten enemy. Then coming to the pupillary dilation, which we'll study again in details in your special senses classes that are coming up, okay. It enhances your visual acuity and perception to make individual environmentally maximal alert. Then stimulation of the brainstem reticular system, it makes individual maximally alert and mentally conscious to take any appropriate decision in quick successions. Then activity of bowel and bladder temporarily ceases due to the constriction of sphincters. So all these are some of the examples of your effects on the different organs due to your fight or flight responses. Okay. So we are over with today's class. The sympathetic division of ANS is completed along with the different neurons and ganglia and their functions. Next class is parasympathetic divisions. Okay. So we'll study it in the next class. And our NS will be completed in your next class. So if you have any doubt till now in NS, you can ask me. Otherwise, we will complete the sympathetic division. So our next class is on Saturday morning 11:30. During that class we will finish our parasympathetic division along with the applied part. Thank you.